What a beautiful cold morning it is. If anyone's finally coming, I'm excited to see you all here. Although I just bogged up my glasses, so I think you're still here. We have a good day today. Today is Children's Sabbath. You'll hear more about that during the day. It is designated the third Sunday of October every year. We don't always do something with it, but in honor of that, I'm wearing my little
thank you.
Please join in our call to worship that is printed for you. Come, people of God, for this is Children's Sabbath. Today, we celebrate all the children of the world, and we accept the challenge of lifting up God's children everywhere. Come, children of God, celebrate God's grace. We come as little children into the loving arms of Christ. Remember, we are not singing today, but we are lifting our hearts in song. Grace calls us beloved children. Our God receives us as loving parents and welcomes us and adores us as a parent loves a child. And in so doing, by God's grace, God makes us whole again as every parent longs to make every child whole. We know that God is able to do so. God is able to make us whole again through the power of Jesus Christ and the love poured out through Jesus. And so we are grateful to God. Let us share our praise.
Amen. reading comes from the book of Exodus. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrew, you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him for 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed him amongst the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance, and she wanted to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside her. She walked and saw that the basket was among the weeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child, and he was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. Then his sister said to the Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse him?" The Pharaoh's daughter said, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him back to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses because, she said, "I drew him out of the water." Our second reading is from Book of Mark, chapter 10, verses 13 through 16. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant, and he said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid hands on them, and blessed them. This is the word of the Lord.
Modern technology at its finest, right there. So, yes, the last couple of weeks have been rough, I will say that. And I'm not going to say too much because you know me, being the emotional basket case that I am. But I do want to say that I thank you all for the prayers and the cards and the texts and the emails and just the phone calls and everything. And I haven't had a chance to talk to every one of you or respond to your texts or your emails or your phone calls, but just know that I appreciate all the love that y'all have given me and my family, and it is so deeply appreciated. And, you know, it's a rough road, and, you know, you're never ready, you know, for someone to pass away. And then when you get two in 2 weeks, it's even a little bit more difficult. But the song, we have had been going through things, but the song I'm going to sing today is called On the Wings of a Dove. And this song was for Dad's funeral yesterday. And this is one of the first songs that my family as children learned when Dad still played the accordion for us as he accompanied us when we started our music careers. So it's not Dad's accordion, but we will give it a whirl. Go ahead, Kim. Can you turn it up just a little bit? On the wings of a snow-white dove, he sends his pure, sweet love, a sign from above. On the wings of a dove, troubles around us, when evil comes, the body grows weak, the spirit grows numb. When these things beset us, he doesn't forget us. He sends down his love on the wings of a dove, on the wings of a snow white dove. He sends his pure sweet love, a sign from above, on the wings of a dove. When Noah had drifted on the flood many days, he searched for land in various ways. Troubles he had some, but wasn't of a snow-white dove. He sends his pure, sweet love, a sign from above, on the wings of a when Jesus went down to the river that day, he was baptized in the usual way. When it was done, God blessed his son. He sent down his of a snow-white dove. He sends his pure, sweet love, a sign from above, on the wings of a dove. On the wings of a snow-white dove, he sends his pure, sweet love, a sign from above.
Somewhere mid-pandemic of this year, When I was thinking about how horribly difficult this season of our lives has been for our very youngest and our very oldest, I heard this story again. I was surfing, looking for things to share with you, and I heard this story again about Moses and the baby, or the baby Moses. This story is the beginning of the rescue story of the people of Israel, and I heard it again in a brand new way this year. God's rescue begins with a child. One child thrown in the river. One child who should not have survived. One child pulled out of water and out of obscurity. One child pulled out of the water by God to begin the salvation story of history. One child, save one child and save the world. The last line of the reading says, verse 10 says, when the child grew up, Miriam brought Moses to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses because, she said, I drew him out of the water. Well, you see, there's this play on words in this. In Hebrew, Moses, or Moshe, is a verb meaning to pull out, or to draw out, Moshe. So one child pulled out of the water and saved. And later on, this Moshe becomes the one who pulls out the people from slavery. The people of Israel are pulled out by the one who pulls out to the one who was pulled out, Moshe. But here's the first step of grace that God shares. Moses, the baby Moses, is drawn out of the water and begins this process. The baby is drawn out of the water with all the hope and all the promise of a life unknown before him. Nobody knows what's going to happen to this baby. But there's great hope when the Pharaoh's daughter pulls this child out of the water. Of course, pulling the child out of water makes me think of baptism, of course. Drawn out of the water with hope and promise. Each time we baptize a child, we don't know where that child's life will lead. We don't know what grace that child will witness to or be a witness of. The story of Moses drawn out of the water, of children being baptized by grace, reminds us of baby baths and squeals of delight and loving hugs wrapped in towels and all the wonderful, warm snuggles of family time, soft time together, and all the hopes of all the mothers and fathers of all times and all places. When we baptize a child, we recognize God's promise of protection and possibility. That's what baptism is about. In the New Testament, when Jesus took the children in his arms and welcomed those children and said, let the children come, we recognize again all the hopes of all the parents of all the world. May they be blessed. May they be held in Jesus' arms. May they be sheltered from the storm. May they be protected and nurtured. May they grow in wisdom and stature. May they become all they are meant to be, all they are blessed to be. May they know God's love all of their days. May they affirm that love and grow into adulthood, and may they share that love and serve God in the world as a blessing to others. Those are our hopes. Every time we baptize a child, every time we hold a child, those are our hopes that we hold for our children and our grandchildren and our godchildren of the church. Those are our dreams that we grasp for those whom we love, even though we're separated That's the covenant promise that we make anytime we baptize a child in the church. You promise every time we baptize a child in the church that we will witness to that child, that we will demonstrate love to that child, that we will embody grace to that child, the grace of Jesus Christ, that we will show that child what love looks like, what love feels like, what love acts like, what love does, to the best of our abilities at all times. That's our promise. That we will teach them Jesus, that we will introduce them to God. Each time a child is drawn out of the waters of baptism, we know that child belongs to Jesus. And we promise to welcome them with loving arms, as Jesus welcomed them with loving arms. So that welcoming and that teaching and that loving and that showing them how to be Christian has become very difficult during this time when you can't even see them, when you can't even be with them. As with so many other things, it has become so difficult during this time. As I said at the start of this sermon, I think this pandemic has been hardest on our very youngest and our very oldest, because in both cases, the isolation has been most profound. We need each other, always. But at those early ages and those later ages, the separation is so hard to process. We need to touch our babies. We yearn to hug our grandparents. Even though we're not blood relations, we desperately, in community, long to be together in our family of faith. And even now, too many are missing from our company, and we're separated. And we don't know for how long. In a church, in a community of believers, when we have pledged to model faith for each other, not just to talk about it, but to show it and live it, how do we teach our children? How can you show a child how to love Jesus when you can't be with the child? How can you help the parents to teach the Bible or teach Christian values when the parents are already struggling to teach math and science and everything else? How can we as a church community be a blessing to you who are our children in the family and our families in the faith? And how can you who are our children best live out our faith in the world, when we can't even be all together at one time? These are struggles that we're asking these days. Now, it can be done. We are doing it. We are living our faith. More than ever, we are needing to live our faith, our Christian values, in our homes, in our everyday lives. We're finding ways. There's so much happening in the world, and God is right there with us in the world, wherever we are and wherever we have been these days. Just as God was with Moses and Miriam and their mother and Pharaoh's daughter, God is with us now. Just as God was there pulling Moses out of the water, God is here pulling us out of whatever we are in. Just as God was with Jesus and the disciples and the parents seeking blessing in those early days, God is with us. God is with you in whatever struggle you're going through, in the Zoom meetings and the faraway grandparenting and the disruptive holidays and the interrupted ordinary time. God is here with us. How do we help each other to recognize God and to see God even when we are not together? How do we honor those baptismal promises we have made to model Jesus when we're not even face to face, when we're not even in the same room? I realize I'm asking a lot of questions these days. We all are. In fact, one good thing about this strange time, this pandemic, and the rearrangement of our lives this year is that people are asking a lot of questions. We have found, we've been forced to reevaluate our lives and think about things in new ways, to prioritize what we value, and to make time for what we value, for the people and the things that matter, and to find a way to connect with what's important, what's really important in our lives. For people of faith, we've had to rethink the way we do things and why we do things. How can we praise God? How should we serve God? How do we learn about God other than being together? Perhaps as a church, we can make time to talk about what matters most, what's happening in the world. Elections and racism, riots, healthcare, inclusion, safety, support for people with challenges, poverty, mental health, homelessness. The list goes on of important things happening that we have to talk about. Perhaps as families, we can have those important conversations as a church. We must help those important conversations to happen in our homes, in our neighborhoods, in our families, among our friends, in our congregation. Talking about God. Talking about what's important. Talking about love and service and grace and forgiveness. That's what it's all about. That's the meaning of life. And extending that conversation out into the world in the way that we live our lives, in the way that we love our neighbors. That's important. Today is designated Children's Sabbath in the Presbyterian Church. It's been happening for 30 years. We don't always observe it. Children's Sabbath is a day to highlight children and the causes of especially poor children in the world by uplifting programs, by thinking about feeding and health care and education. Right now out there, the need is a little bit overwhelming. I have to confess, as I prepared this sermon, honestly, in 35 years of ministry, I've never seen it so bad. Just telling you, there is a lot of need right now. Poverty is over the top, and children are very vulnerable, and you know this. There's so much to be done. At the same time, there is so much you can do. Just pick a cause and give. Just find some time and help. Just pitch in anywhere. There are multiple choices. Anywhere. And it will make a difference. As I started thinking about all the needs of the children in our world, it occurred to me that the best way that we can help all the children in the world is by equipping our children in the world. The children among us, the children you know, your grandchildren, your children, your relatives, your neighbors, your friends, to equip our children among us to be Christ's ambassadors in the world. As we teach them about love, as we teach them that they are loved, as we love them, as we teach them that they are blessed, that they are called, that they are called to care, as we draw them out of the water, out of the chaos, and wrap them in God's love, God's blanket of grace, as they grow in faith, as they live in the world, and as they share that grace with others, like Moses, they go out into the world to pull others out of slavery, chaos, whatever else. They go out into the world to be the one who helps deliver, who knows what miracles these children might do. These among us might offer to the world. What wonders they will work, how they will bless the world because you have blessed them. I can see it. Because you love them. Because you share God's love with them. They will be able to share it with others. Because you show them how to love others, how to be Jesus in a world that is hurting, how to love as Jesus loves. Together we care for the least of these in the world. That's our calling. We pull them out of the darkness into the marvelous light of Jesus Christ. One beloved child at a time. Just like God, save one child, save the world. Amen. I invite you to stand and confess what you believe, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Christian, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sat on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead.
Help us to guide them well and faithfully.
that we may all learn to care and share your love in the world. We also pray for children who are in need here and around the world. We pray for wisdom for those who provide for them, for access to education and health care and any support that they need. We pray for hope, the future, and opportunities to develop. We pray for children who face war or violence or poverty all over the world. Help us to rescue these who are vulnerable and give them the support that they need. We pray for children in foster care that they may know they are loved and valued. We pray for children who are in trouble or on the edge of society. Help them to see alternatives, to make good choices, and to find ways to develop and share their gifts. Inspire us and people all over the world to create systems that support the least among us. We pray for families, for those who are thriving and for those who are struggling. We pray for wisdom for parents and help for those who are facing divorce. We pray for children in all of our homes and all homes everywhere, that they know they're loved and always have what they need, including people to talk to when they're facing stress or anger or challenge. We pray help us provide solutions where needed to be your love in the world. We also ask your blessing today on others with special needs, on those we've named in the service and those whom we hold in our hearts. We pray for those who are sick, those who are hospitalized, those in nursing homes, those who are homebound. We remember those who are bereaved and pray your presence, your comfort. Pray for those who are sad or lonely or anxious or stressed. We pray for those who are seeking jobs or better ways to use their skills and provide for others. We pray for those who are making difficult decisions in the days ahead, and we pray your wisdom. We pray for the hungry, the homeless, the needy. We pray for military and their families, for first responders and medical workers. We pray for all in harm's way and all seeking to help others. We pray for teachers and social workers and all those who work with children. And again, we pray for the children of the world, your children and ours. We are grateful that we are your children, that you love us and provide for us, and that you are always here. Inspire us and use us to care for your children everywhere. We thank you for the love you have given us and shown in Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who taught us to pray as we now pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
and we share that, and we are blessed by that grace that Jesus loves us, that God loves us, and that we are able then to love others. So go out knowing that and share that wonderful good news. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and evermore. Amen.